Now I think it's my privilege to introduce one of the tremendous pillars of the church, Bishop Gracida. I'll quickly state that if there were more bishops, pastors, and spiritual leaders like Bishop Gracida, I would gladly not have a job. And I think he would be the first to admit that the reason we even have the culture war, the situation we do in America and the Western world, is really because of the failure of the church to speak up as she should. Bishop Gracida.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I was born 10 feet below sea level. No, my mother was not swimming in the Gulf of Mexico when she gave birth to me. She was living in the city of New Orleans. The city of New Orleans, as you know from Hurricane Katrina, is a city below sea level, protected from the mighty Mississippi River by very high levees. The Mississippi River at New Orleans is truly an awesome sight. It is not quite a mile wide, but it appears to be much wider. It is 200 feet deep and is flowing past New Orleans at a rate of 3 miles per hour. It moves 600,000 cubic feet of water every second past New Orleans, carrying 436,000 tons of sediment each day into the Gulf of Mexico. Standing on a levee at New Orleans watching the mighty Mississippi River flow past is such an awesome sight that the onlooker should have no difficulty understanding that the river contains the water of 9 other tributary rivers, principally the Missouri and the Ohio. It also has 99 secondary tributary rivers that drain 31 states that constitute 41% of the landmass of the United States and 2 Canadian provinces. Now, my point in describing the awesome size of the Mississippi River is to use it as an analogy to describe for you the awesome power and flow of the culture of death in our society. The culture of death in our society is now at flood stage, and the Mississippi River is a good analogy of this flood of the culture of death flowing daily in our society. The Mississippi River has multiple sources, but its principal source is identified by geographers as the southern end of Lake Itasca in upper Minnesota. The culture of death has multiple sources in the history of Western society, sources that are many and varied. It is reasonable to ascribe one of the primary sources to the writings of the economist Thomas Robert Malthus, an Englishman born in the year 1766. In his book, An Essay on the Principle of Population, published in the year 1798, Malthus wrote, "The power of population is so superior to the power of the earth to produce sustenance for man that premature death must in some shape or other visit the human race. Gigantic, inevitable famine stalks in the rear, and with one mighty blow levels the population without food for the world. Malthus argued that two types of checks hold population within resource limits. Positive checks, which raise the death rate, and preventive ones, which lower the birth rate. The positive checks include hunger, disease, and war. The preventive checks are abortion, birth control, prostitution, and postponement of marriage. In some ways, Robert Thomas Malthus was the Chicken Little of his time. His version of "the sky is falling, the sky is falling" came to be known as the Malthusian catastrophe. It appealed to the popular imagination, became fixed in Western literature. It was inevitable that others would see in the Malthusian catastrophe a basis for grounding their own fears and phobias. One such person was Margaret Sanger. As part of her efforts to promote birth control, Sanger found common cause with proponents of eugenics, believing that eugenics sought to assist the race toward the elimination of the unfit. Margaret Sanger was a proponent of negative eugenics, which aims to improve human hereditary traits through social intervention by reducing the reproduction of those who were considered unfit. Sanger's eugenic policies included an exclusionary immigration policy, free access to birth control methods, and full family planning autonomy for the able-minded, and compulsory segregation or sterilization and abortion for the profoundly retarded. Although Sanger supported negative eugenics, she asserted that eugenics alone was not sufficient and that birth control and abortion were essential to achieve her goals. The reality is that even though Sanger professed to being opposed to abortion, Planned Parenthood, which she helped establish, shifted its emphasis from birth control to abortion. Why, you ask? Because there is much more money to be made from performing abortions than from distributing birth control pills or devices. The love of money is a root of much evil in our society, and as I will show, increases the ever-growing flow of the culture of death in the world. In Corpus Christi, Janet Hart, wife of Edward Hart, the publisher and founder of the Corpus Christi Colored Times, was also the founder of Corpus Christi chapter of both Planned Parenthood and the Federation for Immigration Reform. The goal of the latter, according to its chairman, was the prevention of, quote, brown-skinned Catholics from entering the states from the South. In the joining together of these organizations with disparate goals, we can see how the culture of death grows by combining the energies and resources of their members, all for different purposes or goals. This new eugenics movement began a few decades ago with the coming together of several groups. The original euthanasia eugenics people, bioethics centers, providers of health care, grassroots community organizations, and private foundations. Like the mighty Mississippi River, the contributions of these cultural tributaries all contributed to the flow of the culture of death, swelling it to its present flood stage. The culture of death movement is now all about influence over the minds and hearts of the people who care for the dying. That is, caregivers, physicians, nurses, chaplains, social workers, to name just a few, so that they can control the timing and place of death. A group of social engineers was able to succeed without drawing much attention from the pro-life movement, which was preoccupied during the last quarter of the 20th century with the fight against abortion, abortion on demand. These social engineers, joined by financial interests, are so close to their ultimate goal of making their version of end-of-life care mandatory. I am indebted to Elizabeth Wickham of the Life Tree website for much of the following history of the culture of death. The modern euthanasia movement in America emerged in the 1930s and was known as the Euthanasia Society of America. Euthanasia proponents sold themselves as pain relief for the dying. Their first strategy was to secure legalization of passive euthanasia, or the withholding and withdrawing of medical treatment, as a way to change public opinion to accept active euthanasia, commonly known as physician-assisted suicide. But there were conflicts within the movement. And by the year 1980, there came to be two distinct wings when the more militant wing broke off. We are all familiar with the militants. There are various organizations over the years, including, for example, the Hemlock Society, Compassion and Choices, Death with Dignity, and their successes in legalizing assisted suicide. But the moderates have remained the proverbial elephant in our living rooms. They have distinguished themselves from the radicals by arguing that they offer the moral high ground. They seem to have disappeared, but the evidence shows that they have quietly drifted into the new field of palliative medicine. In her year 2005 book, author Diana Lynn describes palliative medicine, palliative care, as the third path to death. It is not wholly natural. It is not suicide. It is something in between. These moderates insist there is a big difference between withholding and withdrawing medical treatment and giving someone access to a lethal dose of barbiturates. The more militant, on the other hand, see little or no difference. During the last quarter of the 20th century, medicine was changing. In the year 1987, hospice physicians met in Granby, Colorado, to form what later became known as the American Academy for Hospice and Palliative Medicine, which is now the professional organization for palliative physicians. Many foundations funded this low-profile euthanasia movement, but two stand out as leaders. The Robert Wood Johnson Foundation funded research and infrastructure, and George Soros's Project for Death in America funded a cadre of professionals. In the last 20 years, these two foundations have provided several hundred million dollars to advance their version of palliative care into our American healthcare system and worldwide. During this time, the Clinton attempt at healthcare reform had failed. Death and dying was a hot topic. Enter George Soros in the mid-1990s. His 1994 speech at Columbia Presbyterian Medical Center announcing the formation of Project on Death in America included this summary statement, and I quote, "The mission of the Project on Death in America is to promote a better understanding of the experiences of dying and bereavement, and by doing so, help transform the culture surrounding death." In November of the year 1995, Soros called 20 foundations together who were committed to transforming the culture of dying. In addition to Soros' Project on Death in America, his Open Society Institute and the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, the list of attendees included many of people know and other foundations, such as the AARP, the Commonwealth Fund, the Greenwald Foundation, the Rockefeller Foundation. The river of the culture of death really began to increase its speed and volume in the year 1967. In that fateful year, Dr. Christian Bernard performed the first transplantation of a human heart from one man to another. The first man died within a few days, but on his second attempt, Dr. Bernard succeeded in transplanting a human heart, and the recipient of the heart lived long enough for the operation to be judged a complete success. There was only one problem. A human organ cannot be transplanted from the body of a dead person to the body of a living person. It cannot. It is medically impossible. The organ must come from a living person to be successfully received by a living person. How to resolve this dilemma? The way Dr. Bernard solved the problem was by keeping the donor's blood flowing artificially with a heart pump and by forcing the lungs to work with a respirator. Now, that is difficult and frequently is unsuccessful in its efforts to keep the donor's body alive. The answer to the problem is obvious to the medical profession. Change the legal definition of death from cardiac pulmonary brain death to simply brain death. And so, a year after Dr. Bernard's transplantation of a human heart, a meeting of doctors involved in human organ transplantation was called at Harvard University to explore how death could be redefined to facilitate human organ transplantation. Now, I'm indebted to my friend Dr. Paul Byrne, founder of My Life Guardian Foundation, for guiding me through the technical aspects of brain death. As complicated as the coined terms brain death, heart beating donor, and death by cardiac death, non-heart beating donor death, appear to be, in reality, it's as simple as 1, 2, 3. Death by cardiac death, in the recent past, was known as the non-heart beating death. Is the preparation of a living human person to be dissected alive for the sole purpose of cutting out vital organs. It is living human experimentation. The living human person, the patient victim, is filled with chemicals to ensure the viability of the organs. Literally, the organs are being preserved within the cavity of the living person until such time it is convenient to cut out the organs. When the heart is finally stopped, either when it is cut out or stopped prior to the excision of other organs, death is pronounced and resuscitation measures are taken, as life must be present since vital organs from someone truly dead are not suitable for transportation. Killing the patient in the process of dissection was known and acknowledged from the very beginning of transplantation. In the early years, no particular terminology was used to label the method or means in which a patient was so no longer considered human, respected, and valued as a person in need of medical attention, compassion, and ongoing treatment, care for his or her well-being. Although the terms non-heart-beating death and death by cardiac death were not used. These were the basic original methods used to get organs prior to the contrivance of brain death. The practice of organ transplantation was neither legal nor was it condoned by the majority within the medical establishment at the time. It was, however, a continuation of over hundreds of years of human medical experimentation. And those conducting such surgical procedures did so very discreetly. In 1968, it was determined to expand human medical experimentation without fear of legal repercussion. And this necessitated the reinvention of the definition of death at the Harvard Conference. Having made public the miracle of transplantation, the new modern medical technology, as it was proposed and promised, would save the lives of countless organ recipients. And it has. What was not divulged was the fact that human life was sacrificed for the betterment of the human life of others. This act of killing and efforts to conceal this involved an elaborate deception, phenomenal indeed, yet quite simplistic in terms. The process of conjuring the coined term brain death and the so-called criteria that accompanied it in theory was not substantiated by any scientific means whatsoever. The expansion of human medical experimentation was a carefully contrived scheme consisting of a well-articulated label to dehumanize the patient to be pronounced dead when in fact the patient is still alive. The method for brain death is primarily the same as the old non-heart beating death. However, the patient victim is pronounced dead long before the actual cutting out of vital organs and prior to the heart being stopped. But for the term non-beating heart death to be marketed and legalized 40 years ago wasn't realistic. Whereas the development of the term brain death was to be the means to develop an acceptable term, to gain public support, and thereby to pass laws to overturn the only true definition of physical death, which everyone will encounter as a physical end of life. And what is that definition? The true definition of human death is the absence of respiration, heartbeat, and circulation that is beyond any form of resuscitation or life support. Let me repeat it. The true definition of human physical death is the absence of respiration, heartbeat, and circulation that is beyond any form of resuscitation or life support. 13 individuals, all directly involved in organ transplantation, gathered at Harvard University and invented the new definition of death. One of the members of this elite group, known as the Ad Hoc Committee, a religious leader, by the way, was also a euthanasia enthusiast. By coincidence. The invention of brain death and the contrived criteria then became known as the Harvard criteria. The upheaval and controversy in which the new invention of brain death and the expansion of human medical experimentation that immediately ensued within the medical communities wasn't enough to stop the social revolution long since started by Robert Malthus, Margaret Sanger, et aliorum. Despite the numerous articles published by respected physicians openly denouncing this movement to subvert truth, the misrepresentation of science and the undermining of the oath of Hippocrates, the lie became accepted by the medical and legal professions. Some transplant surgeons and physicians were charged with murder, but that did not stop the flow of the river of the culture of death. You see, there were no moral boundaries, no moral voice other than the weak internal voice of the Judeo-Christian faith within the hearts and minds of medical profession and the sciences, which ultimately opposed this. A deadly code of silence, creating a moral vacuum, enabled brain death and organ transplantation to be pursued, was entirely due to the church's compliancy and complacency. I repeat that condemnation. A deadly code of silence, creating a moral vacuum, enabling brain death and organ transplantation to be pursued, was due to the church's compliancy and complacency. Since 1954, when legislation imposed 501c3 tax status for churches, the tax exemption law, and appointed the IRS as the authoritative entity to oversee and govern all the political activities of the church, no longer were issues that were considered controversial discussed by the church for fear of endangering their tax exempt status. The church in this era was well aware of the political maneuvering as a dark, powerful agenda was clearly underway. By the time of the controversy of brain death and organ transplantation that surfaced in the year 1968, the political climate was much the same. Now, the church had by then had those years of experience of being completely submissive. The church leaders were not to be expected to have the medical or scientific expertise in which to accurately assess brain death, this new death, or to have a full understanding. They were, however, commissioned and morally obligated to seek and uphold the truth as revealed and taught by others. The religions, in an eerie silence, conformed without any resistance. From sea to shining sea, there wasn't so much as a peep from any pulpit with regard to brain death and organ transplantation. In the year 1973, abortion was legalized, and the medicine these men and women of faith had once known and loved was literally stripped from them as death, and in a continuance, was expanding in method and established in law. In the year 1980, the Uniform Determination of Death Act was recommended to be adopted by all the states to make it uniformly legal that brain death is equal to cardiac and pulmonary death. The warning of the slippery slope many years previously of the moral decadence had come full circle and to a dreadful proverbial end. Death in a variety of names and means exploded throughout the country. Launched was the most extensive propaganda campaign ever known. The gift of life through organ transplantation was hailed as the new gift of medical science. People's lives would be saved by having organs transplanted. The deception was continued since its conception to be the most successfully socially engineered process ever developed. The fallacy of brain death, the illusion of organ transplantation, being the miracle of modern medicine, and it has corrupted our society. If there was any validity whatsoever, any real concern about saving lives, the invention of brain death would have been stopped before it began. The issue of money and power, brain death was nothing more or less than the social engineering developed to revolutionize our country through the corruption of the expression saving lives, when the opposite is intended, that is, taking lives. The United States currently operates under an opt-in program that requires potential organ donors to register either online or at the local directory of motor vehicles. This system yields approximately 26 donors per million people. So now we come to the campaign to convert the system of organ donation from voluntary to involuntary, from opt-in to opt-out. Most of the countries of Europe have either adopted laws legalizing presumed consent or are considering such adoption. As it stands, the burden of proof is being placed on potential donors when it should be placed on those who do not want to participate. The radical social engineers maintain that the United States must change its stance from opt-in to opt-out, making it so that those who do not want their organs to be donated must actively register themselves as non-donors. Do not allow presumed consent to become the law in this country. On the table in the back, I've placed some booklets given to me by Dr. Paul Byrne, founder of the Foundation for Life. And in the back of those booklets, you will see a card which you can fill out and have notarized, which will help protect you from presumed donation of your organs against your will. The issues surrounding brain death are in truth as simple now as they were upon their invention. The truth is, the donor is breathing, has a beating heart, and a circulatory system in which the sustaining of the human life and life is evident. The donor is killed during the process of dissection for the sole purpose of organ transplantation and human medical experimentation. Every donor eventually takes his or her last breath. The heart stops beating and circulation ceases. Every donor experiences true physical death. The organ donor is alive. Why isn't that truth enough? Now, the force that carries the Mississippi River to flow from Minnesota to the Gulf of Mexico is gravity. Lake Itasca in Minnesota is 1,494 feet above sea level, above the Gulf of Mexico. And so the water naturally flows from Minnesota to the Gulf of Mexico. The forces that cause the flow of the culture of death to increase in volume and rate of growth are materialism, a secular view of society, and money, especially money. You have no idea how much money is involved in the organ transplant industry that depends on brain death as the definition of physical death. Let me give you some idea how much money is involved. The Milliman Research Foundation every 3 years reports on the cost of every organ transplantation that takes place in the United States. Their last report was for the year 2011. And I quote from their report. Here is the average total cost for each of the following categories of organ transplant. First, the number of each type of transplant, then the average cost of each single transplant. Bone marrow received from others, 6,894 transplantations, each one costing $805,000. Bone marrow from self, 13,203 transplantations, each one costing an average of $363,000. Cornea transplants, 46,981, each one costing an average of $24,000. Heart transplants, 2,161, each one costing an average of $997,000, $1 million. Intestine transplant, 74 took place, each one costing $1,206,000. Kidney transplants, 16,000, each one costing an average of $262,000. Liver transplants, 5,998, each one costing an average of $577,000. Single lung transplant, 734 took place, each one costing an average of $561,000. double lung transplants. 1,050 took place, each one costing an average of $797,000. Pancreas transplants, 286 took place. Average cost, $289,000. Heart and lung transplant, 30 took place. Average cost, $1,248,400. Intestine plus other organs, 107, costing an average of $1,343,200. Heart and kidney, 66 transplants, each costing an average of $1,296,500. Kidney and pancreas, 867 transplants, average cost $474,000. Liver and kidney, 369 transplants, average cost $1,026,000. Other multi-organ transplants, 42, average cost $1,707,500. Total of all of these transplants, all of those transplants cost $762,058,513. That's $750 million. Do you mean to tell me that that much money doesn't cause the river of the culture of death to flow with increasing speed? Believe me, it does. I'll close now with a few ad lib remarks about the case of Johnny McMahon. You'll recall that she was a 13-year-old girl, went into a hospital in Oakland, California for a routine tonsillectomy. The tonsillectomy was performed, excuse me. And immediately after the operation, she hemorrhaged and suffered cardiac arrest. Three doctors, one of them associated with Stanford University Medical School, declared her brain dead. Now, it doesn't take much imagination to understand that 13-year-old girl's organs were worth a lot of money. I mean, 13 years old, all of her organs must have been worth over $1 million, $2 million, $3 million. So naturally, the hospital moved to remove the organ. The parents rejected. And they wanted to transfer her to another hospital. The hospital refused. They went to court. The court said, well, the only way that we'll allow you to remove her from this hospital in Oakland to another facility is if she's declared dead by a coroner. So the coroner, with the help of the doctors from Stanford, declared her dead. And a death certificate was issued, and she was taken by the parents to New Jersey, where state law in New Jersey allows a quote brain dead patient to be kept alive. She's been alive now for 10 months in New Jersey. And recently she has begun to respond to the medical care that she's receiving. She is not yet fully conscious, but she does respond to commands from her mother and father. She responds to touches. She is showing more and more sentient awareness of her existence. And so the family retained a lawyer in California to ask the court to revoke the death certificate. yesterday before yesterday, on Thursday of this week, the judge had a hearing, and the lawyer from Stanford who had declared her brain dead said that she's not really alive, and therefore the death certificate should be allowed to remain. The parents had asked for a postponement of any further consideration of their lawsuit, and so the judge has delayed it for 3 months. During this 3 month period, I urge you, I ask you to pray. Somehow, God, in His mercy, will allow Jahi McMath to regain full consciousness. I can think of nothing that will give the lie to the proponents of brain death greater than to have Jahi McMath alive and walking and talking. Thank you.
Glad we captured that on tape. It's a very, very serious, very important talk. We're going to schedule for a short break, and I want to thank Bishop Gracida and Jim for getting us back on schedule. Is anybody ready for a break, or can we dispense, or would you like a 5 minute break? Oh, you, a few questions to His Excellency Bishop. Would you be willing to feel some?
Sure. I think there's a mic there. Paul, take the microphone. Is that on?
As I acknowledged in my talk.
Check. 1, 2, 3, I get to talk.
As I acknowledged in my talk, I'm greatly indebted to Dr. David Byrne, who is a neonatologist and an expert. For my medical knowledge, so don't put me to the test. I'm not a doctor. Go ahead.
Archbishop, many of you, I guess some of you at least, would be familiar with Archbishop Gomez's booklet on end of life issues and deals with, he writes on transplants in general. I think I have read it, but I don't remember. And there's just a little bit of confusion because, I mean, transplants are allowed by the Catholic Church, but heart transplants may or do, you see, they do definitely end the life, they cannot be transplanted. Do you understand my question? I'm trying to word it. They cannot be transplanted because they cause the death. It's murder. Do you understand my question?
No, I'm afraid I don't. Does the church actually allow heart organ transplantation? The answer is yes. Yes, the popes have spoken very positively. Pope Saint John Paul II spoke positively about organ donation and transplantation, and so is Pope Benedict XVI. But in principle, there is nothing wrong with the donation of organs. However, what is wrong is the killing of a person in order to effect the transplantation. It is possible to transplant the organs when a person really is being kept alive after dying, what would normally be considered a normal cardiac or pulmonary death, being kept alive with instruments and machines so that the organs can be transplanted. So it is possible, but the routine today, the medical practice today, is to really depend upon the cessation of brain activity. While there's still nothing wrong with the heart is beating normally. The lungs are expelling air, even though air may be forced in by a respirator, the lung naturally forces the air out. So the person is alive, is living. So what the medical practice is, to continue that natural life artificially until they are able to, at the right moment, declare the person totally dead and remove the organs. Now, that is what the church does not approve of. But if it is possible for the doctor to to sustain the person after their cardiac stoppage, when the person dies from cardiac arrest, and if the lung can be kept operating, then the person can be considered to be truly in the process of dying a natural death, and it is possible to remove the organs and to transplant them. Does that answer your question?
That's very helpful. So you're saying right now the more common way is not to wait for true death, but to murder someone and transplant.
Exactly. When they have the electroencephalogram connected to the brain, and they detect an absence of brain waves in the cortex, which is one of the main parts of the brain and the base of the brain, they then declare the person brain dead, even though the heart may be beating naturally, not artificially, not being sustained by machine, and the lungs may be working either without the aid of a respirator or with the aid of a respirator. A respirator doesn't force the lungs to operate totally. It merely puts air into the lungs, and then the natural reaction of the body is to exhale, okay? So a respirator is not really the same thing as an iron lung. An iron lung forces air in and pulls air out. That's an iron lung, as we remember from the days of polio, okay? But a respirator doesn't do that. A respirator merely puts air into the lung, and then the body naturally exhales and expels the air. So if the heart is beating naturally, and if the lungs are functioning naturally, even though the brain activity may be hard to detect, it is wrong for them to declare the person brain dead and proceed to cut out the organs. That's the point, okay? Answer your question. It's very complicated, and if I've confused you, I'm sorry, but it is not a simple matter for a layman to explain. All right.
Thank you, Dixon. That pretty much answers one of my questions. The other one was from a more of like a theological point of view and a guide to us going forward. In terms of opting in to organ transplant, the biblical statement from Christ about no greater love hath a man that he lay down his life for his friends, is that not appropriate as a translation for somebody who willingly, as a donor, accepts the technical medical realities that by the great, in their own mind, for the greater good of family or whoever they're donating to, that it goes this way? Is it still morally wrong to willingly give, as it were, one's life in the process of donation to help somebody else? Is that something we're willing to do?
Could you a short summary?
Yes. If in other words, with the biblical injunction, laying down your life for a friend, would it be a moral decision for a person to make, even knowing that the organ might be taken before their natural death, would that be a moral choice that a person could make and not without sinning?
Certainly, if you are help qualify that, I would say that there's a moral doubt about signing a donation form not knowing how your organs are going to be harvested. That is probably morally questionable, all right? I would say a person can sign a form saying they want their organs to be donated, but they should stipulate that they can only be donated after natural death, not brain death. Okay? Brain death is an artificial definition used to enable doctors to harvest organs from living people. Natural death can occur in a way that enables organs to be taken before the person really stops total existence. Okay?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Bishop Gracida, may I ask about the church's, in my judgment, failure to address the issue of euthanasia of the elderly in withholding basic treatment for a person who is admitted to a hospital and is an elder. An antidote, my personal experience with my mother 2 years ago, we were in a minor automobile accident, only took her to the hospital because of her age for evaluation, told by the doctors that she was dying even though she was talking, and there was no apparent reason for that diagnosis, but they recommended that she be admitted. Within a week, my mother actually was dying, but she was dying because they were withholding proper medication and treatment. It required that her doctor happen to come into town from a conference. He had been away at the time of the accident. He told us that they were refusing to allow him, even without permission, to review her medical records. At my husband's insistence, who was a physician, they finally allowed her doctor to review her medical record. He told us that if we allowed her to stay in this hospital, she would truly be dead within 3 days. But if we allowed her to be transported to another hospital under his care, he felt he could save her. But he said that they had allowed her condition to debilitate so badly that the transfer would be risky. We agreed as a family to transfer her to the hospital her physician was a member of. Within 3 days, with just basic treatment, with a basic old medication called Lasix, they removed 5 liters of fluid from her lungs that had been allowed to accumulate by withholding treatment, and she was home within 3 days. She is now 98 and a half years old and participates in all of our family activities and is sorely missed if she misses any family activity by all the younger great-grandchildren. So this is an example of withholding of basic treatment from an elderly person because of the physicians. And we were alerted to the problem of withholding treatment because I kept saying to the doctors, why is she dying? What is the medical diagnosis that you're using to say that she is at risk of dying? And I was told repeatedly that they were making her comfortable. Finally, I realized what that meant. So, Bishop Gracida, what are we doing to contribute in our church to the value of the life of the elderly? Because my mother's presence in this world is very valuable to her family. Thank you, Bishop Gracida. If you'd please respond.
Thank you for that all too common tragic story of the continuation of treatment that is all too often not really treatment, but merely preparation for the removal of organs. I sympathize with you and your family over the tragedy, the tragic circumstances that your mother had to endure for all those weeks and months. But it is a story that is repeated over and over and over. Now, we really cannot be here all day answering individual cases. I'll take one more question, but please make it a question.
I don't think it's really a big thing for just ordinary people to have common sense and know about these things. About that 13-year-old girl, it was an uncle that touched her arm, and she moved it. And those people know that when you're dead, you're very sick and cold. And they're the ones that saved their own relative, their daughter, with great insistence. And you have to be very, very insistent because there is euthanasia happening in our town all the time. It has to do with money, Medicare, and those dollars. And it is happening here, so we should all be aware and alert. And I think common sense would do us a lot of good.
Was a question.
It was not a question.
Thank you very much.